form of filing. So so notice that there is a laundry list of stuff that we need to be mindful of. You must have a written declaration that the good is qualified as originating. You must provide the number and the date of entry. You must give a copy of certificate of origin, a written statement whether importer of good provided the entry summary, and whether there has been any refund or awareness of the refund. You have the fourth section is a written statement whether the protest has been or request for the reliquidation has been filed. So notice this is a laundry list 1 through 4, and customs usually test on laundry list as by providing you a question which is not, so they all of the stuff will be included in a laundry list but with that one particular question. So let's see how it's been tested. We have 520D claim, right? So 520D claim, and this may not necessarily relate to NAFTA, folks. This can also relate to a bunch of other free trade agreements. NAFTA is a major part. So if you are being tested on free trade agreements, usually customs do not break it down. Free trade agreement section and NAFTA, free trade agreement section and other stuff, they can properly identify section as free trade agreement, or it can be thrown out as other, right, at the end of the customs broker exam. So those labels may or may not be relevant, but 1 year after the date of importation is always there. So whenever, here a customs examiner stated NAFTA 1520D claim, right? So they kind of expect you to know what 520D means, even though it's that statute has been codified in the regulation, still they refer to this under the statutory language. So that's a very important part. So post NAFTA claim may be denied for all the following reasons except, right? So we're looking for the reason that where customs can deny. So as you recall, there is a substantive aspect such as non-qualifying product, and there is a procedural aspect such as failure to make a declaration or provide a certificate of origin. So with that in mind, let's take a look at the answer choices. Failure to file timely. Yes, if you outside, if you file 2 years after the date, 2 years after the date of importation, automatic denial, no question asked. So A fits the bill because we're looking for exception. Failure to submit the claim on a CBP Form 19. CBP Form 19 is the form for the protest. It is the form that you protest the exaction of duties or fees under the Section 514. Customs, again, has taken the position that 1520D and 1514 are exclusive, so you must avail yourself of 1520D procedures rather than 1514 procedures. All right, so whether that will be true in years ahead, I do not know. But irrespective of that, CBP Form 19, the protest form, is not part of the 1520D claim. It's not part of the equation. So, and it's not listed, obviously, over here or anywhere. You have CBP Form 434, right? Know that Certificate of Origin is CBP Form 434. That's important to know because that way you are not confusing it with CBP Form 19, right? Let's see, where do we have that number? Usually at the bottom. Yes, CBP Form 434. That's an NAFTA claim. So keep that in mind. CBP Form 19 is not required. And of course, if you file something on 15 CBP Form 19, you're indicating you are making not a 1520D claim, but 1514 claim. So submitting it may cause problems, not failure to submit it. So if you, it's better not to submit it. So in this case, I think B fits the bill, right? So B is the correct answer choice. Let's take a look at the other ones. Failure to provide certificate of origin. Well, we know that CBP form 434 certificate of origin is on the laundry list of the requirements. Certificate of origin is a must. So may be denied. It probably will be denied if you fail to provide it. So C is not our choice. Failure for imported goods to qualify as originating good following initiation of origin verification. Well, that's the substantive requirement. If your product doesn't meet tariff shift, if your product does not meet wholly obtained or produced criteria, whatever other criteria, marking criteria, or whatever other criteria that is out there, then if you don't meet the substantive requirement, that's a denial as well. So this it is not an exception, if you will. So D is not our choice. Interesting way how customs examiners put it, break it down in one and two, but let's move on. Failure to submit three written statements, so three statements indicating the following. Whether or not the importer of goods provided the copy of entry summary, whether or not the importer of goods is aware of any claim for refund, and whether or not the person have filed petition, protest or a petition for reliquidation. So first one is copy of the entry summary. Copy of the entry summary is available over here. So it's a must under the procedural requirement. So this one is okay. Awareness of claim for refund. We also saw that as a part of the requirement. Awareness of a claim for refund. So this then the second option is also okay. And the third option is filing a protest or petition to request a reliquidation is provided here, protest or a petition to for reliquidation, copy and paste under any provision of law is also part of the laundry list. So third point is okay, making E not a reason to deny, it's rather the opposite, it is something that is required. So under this, so this is another way how customs test you on a laundry list. So under one answer, under one answer choice, they just throw in three elements. This is the beauty of the multiple choice examination is because by providing you with all those answers, they can test you on so many topics in one question, right? Here, they just tested you in one answer choice, they tested you on three instead of one. So this is really should be A, B, C, D, E, F, G answer choice type, not E. But this is another example of how customs examiners can get creative. The best we can do is be aware and come prepared. So B is good for this one.